there are a lot of people today that are saying that, you know, change is not possible. And I think we need to look at it through the eyes of what is the goal when you enter into that therapy. So you have some studies of which we're going to put below that people can link to. And a lot of people will say from the LGBT community today that, that you know, these therapies are so damaging. But what the goal is for many people is in coming to Christ and developing a relationship with Jesus Christ. It doesn't necessarily mean that when that person comes out of homosexuality that they're turning into heterosexuality. Although there are counselors that will talk to somebody about if that's your goal and your design and your plan, we can help you along those lines. What are your thoughts as it relates to leaving homosexuality as to whether somebody is obtaining heterosexuality or if they're walking in faith in agreement with Christ? That might actually just mean that I'm going to live a celibate life now.
Right. This is a big topic. It includes a lot of people. And so for some people, it's going to be that all of their feelings of same-sex attraction are going to go away, and they'll be able to be married to a person of the opposite sex and have a happy, satisfying life. I know cases like that of both men and women who have been involved in opposite sex relationships for a long time, you know, so I know that that's possible. So that at one end, you've got people who successfully leave the LGBT lifestyle and successfully live with another person of the opposite sex, and they do that for a long time. Then you have people who leave the lifestyle and who are celibate. Then you have people who have lessening of their same-sex attraction, but not completely. They don't completely lose it, and they have struggles with it. You have people who've been traumatized, and part of their LGBT experience involves some kind of trauma, either trauma when they were younger, which led them into the lifestyle, or trauma that they've experienced since they've lived in the gay lifestyle. A lot of people don't actually enjoy it very much and would like to be doing something else, you know? So there's that whole batch of people. So when you ask, does it work? You got to ask yourself, well, what are you talking about? What do you mean? And the studies that look at it look at the question of, did it lessen the sense of attraction? Did it lessen the behavior? Did it lessen the feelings? And that counts as kind of a win. And what I would like to say about that is, if you look at psychological therapy generally, and you ask, well, does therapy for depression, does it work? And the answer is, well, sometimes it does and sometimes it doesn't, right? And sometimes it works partially and sometimes it works for a while and then something happens in your life and it doesn't work anymore, you know, so to speak. And so if your criteria is that you never experience the symptom again, you know, you go into therapy for a troubling symptom and your criterion for success is you never experience that symptom again, ever, ever. Well, that's a threshold that really almost no therapy could possibly achieve that threshold. But, you know, when you really stop and think about what's being demanded of the so-called reparative therapy or the so-called conversion therapy, you know, it's a very high bar that they're asking. So that's another thing to keep in mind as you're just conversing with people about this. And they say, well, it doesn't work. You get to ask, and you should ask, well, what do you mean by work? You know, what does it mean to say that it succeeds or it doesn't succeed?
Yeah, I think that, you know, there are two parts. When I go for counseling, I'm getting information from the therapist and from the professional, but I have a part to play in that too, as to whether I make an application to the things that they're suggesting to me. And there are some people that say, well, you know, the feelings didn't go away. From a perspective of the Bible and religion, I'm called to continually surrender my temptations to God throughout my whole life. So if I believe in the power of Jesus Christ, as I draw into a closer relationship with Him, I'm more successful the more I develop an intimate relationship with Jesus Christ. And I would say that's when it works. But for people who are listening more to their feelings and maybe denying the power of Jesus Christ, you'd be more inclined to fall back and live how you used to live.
Well, and even if you do fall back and live as you used to live, you can shake it off and say, okay, I dropped the ball, but I'm gonna repent and I'm gonna go forward, you know.
Yeah.
And that I would say that's a very common experience for people, for example, who experience any kind of addictive process. right? Think about that. You know, think about people who are addicted to pornography or people who are sex addicts or people who are alcoholics, you know, they don't get better all at once. Yeah, I mean, sometimes they do. So, you know, sometimes the Lord will change you instantly, right? That does happen. But we have no right to expect that, right? When we've created habits of thinking and behaving, and we got friends who are encouraging us in a certain way and so on, we have no right to expect that it's all going to go away instantly, right? So part of it is the supernatural level, which you're describing there, the walk with Christ, but also at the natural level, you can see this, that it's a process, right? And it's not going to be perfect or without lumps. And that's why I think the attempt to ban conversion therapy and the attempt to say that it is harmful to people to even try to change your sexual orientation, that's why that's so destructive. And it's very important that people resist that message, because the idea that attempting to change your patterns of thoughts and feelings and behavior, that that's intrinsically harmful, that's not fair to anybody, in my opinion.
I think what you're saying is very balanced and fair. You know, it's kind of a two-way street to basically say it's only a one-way street of, sorry, we're just going to cut this off and we can't even attempt this. It is fair to say some people have success, some people don't. That's what we have statistically proven over any type of change, like you said, drugs or any addictions or
lately.
Yeah, it's only fair to say that the data shows us that there's good and bad on both sides of these fence. But it sounds like the picture they're painting is it's all bad and it should not be done in any case or scenario or anything whatsoever. I mean, to the point that you can't even talk about it, you will be tried and convicted. I mean, they're getting to that level where they're just going to hush it up.
Yes, yes.